All right, we have a lot to cover in this video, so I'm going to go through this first material fairly quickly. When we have a set of data and we create a histogram for that set of data, that histogram can look like a lot of things, but here are four potential histograms that some set of data might look like. In this first histogram in the top left corner, all of our bars seem to be about the same height. We then say that that data is evenly distributed or uniformly distributed. We might say that this is a rectangular distribution. This next histogram in green has a bit of a tail here on the right side of the distribution. When that's the case, we say that this data is skewed right. Our next histogram has a tail on the left side of the distribution, so we say that this data is skewed left. Over here, it looks like our data has two maximum values, or two modes, so we call this distribution bimodal. The type of distribution that we're going to be talking about for the rest of this video, though, is called a normal distribution. And a normal distribution looks something like this. A normal distribution has a mean right in the middle, and the distribution is symmetric about that mean. It also turns out that for a normal distribution, the mean, the median, and the mode are all right here in the middle at the same value. We often say that a normal distribution has a bell-shaped curve to it. And let me show you a couple of normal distributions for comparison purposes. Let's say these two distributions have the same mean, median, and mode. Let's say that this first distribution looks something like this, and the second distribution looks something like that. What we can say if we're comparing these two sets is that this one over here has a larger standard deviation. That's because the data seems to be spread out a little bit more. There's a little bit more variety in the data. But the cool thing about normal distributions is, regardless of what the mean is and regardless of what the standard deviation is, we can say a lot of things about the data. Let's talk about that with another normal distribution. So here's the best bell-shaped graph I could come up with. Our mean is right here in the middle. I'm just estimating that right here is going to be the mean plus one standard deviation. Over here is going to be the mean minus one standard deviation. And what's cool is, regardless of what the actual value of the mean is and what the actual value of the standard deviation is, we can say that for a normal distribution, 68% of our data is going to fall right in between those two values. What that means is, if we add up all of our data values that fall in right here, that would represent 68% of our data. Now let's take that out a little further to another standard deviation. Let's say this value out here is the mean plus two standard deviations. And let's say over here is the mean minus two standard deviations. What we can say then is that the amount of data that falls in between those two data values is 95%. And let's go out one standard deviation further, and what we're going to find is that 99.7% of our data for a normal distribution falls within three standard deviations of the mean. Now I'm going to shrink this down a little bit to make some room, because I want to give you some actual numbers to look at here. Let's take a look at the distribution for IQ scores. The mean IQ score, which I'll call mu, is 100, and the standard deviation for IQ scores is typically 10. And IQ scores are normally distributed, so if we look at this graph, we would have a mean of 100 here right in the middle. Our mean plus one standard deviation would be 100 plus 10, or 110. Our mean minus one standard deviation would be 100 minus 10, or 90. We could continue filling this graph out. We would have 120 over here and 130 IQ over here. We would have an IQ of 80 over here and an IQ of 70 over here. Now, based on what we know about normal distributions, we can say that 68% of our IQ scores are going to fall between 90 and 110. We can also say that 95% of our IQ scores fall between 80 and 120. We could even go a little bit further with this and say that, knowing that this entire region between the blue lines here is 68% of the data, then this region in here must represent 34% of the data. That was half of 68. So we can say that 34% of our IQ scores fall between 90 and 100. Okay, and you can imagine that we could say a lot more things about normal distributions based on these rules up here. And all these rules combined, we call the empirical rule for normal distributions. And while the empirical rule is great and it gives us a lot of nice information, it's a little bit limiting, because we can't just pick a random data value, say a half of a standard deviation above the mean, and ask questions about how much data is above and below that value. So to handle this, we're going to look at one more big normal distribution. This time, let's just call this mean mu. We're going to call the mean plus one standard deviation mu plus sigma. Those are the two Greek symbols for mean and standard deviation. We're going to call the mean minus one standard deviation mu minus sigma. The mean plus two standard deviations is then going to be mu plus two sigma. And the mean plus three standard deviations will be mu plus three sigma. Now we're going to talk about z-scores. Regardless of what the mean of a data set is and what the standard deviation of that data set is, if we have a data value that happens to be one standard deviation above the mean, we give that data value a z-score of 1. Any data value that is two standard deviations above the mean, we give a z-score of 2. And a data value three standard deviations above the mean, we give a z-score of 3. If a data value is right at the mean, then it has a z-value of 0. If a data value is below the mean by one standard deviation, we give it a z-score of negative 1. And likewise, over here, we have a z-score of negative 2 and a z-score of negative 3. So let's say we have some random data value, and it happens to have a z-score over here, and its z-score is negative 1.73. And we might be interested in asking the question, what percentage of the data in this big set that we have falls below this particular z-score? Well, as it turns out, we have tables that can help us with this. And I'm going to bring this table up in a second, but just as a reminder, we are looking for the amount of data in this set that falls left of this z-score of negative 1.73. We need to remember, negative 1.73. Okay, I'm going to bring up the table from your homework, and this table gives us the area to the left of our z-score. That's what we want when our z-value is negative, which is what we have. Our z-score was negative 1.73. So what we do is we go down this table over here to negative 1.7. And since our z-score is negative 1.73, that's going to be represented by this square right here. And this is telling us that out of 1, that the probability that a data value is going to fall below our z-score of negative 1.73 is going to be 0.0418, or in other words, 4.18% of our data is going to fall below that z-score. So what we did is we looked up this z-score in our table, and our table gave us a value of 0.0418. We typically call that the area under this curve. We say that the total area under this normal distribution is 1, and out of that 1, 0.0418 of that is right here in this region over here. Now, to answer the question, what percentage of the data in the set falls below the z-score? Well, that is just 4.18%. Now, having done that, we can also answer the question, what percentage of our data would fall above that z-score? Well, we got 0.0418 from our table, and the entire area under the curve we said was 1, so we can subtract 0.0418 from the entire area of 1 to get 0.9582, or in other words, 95.82% of our data falls above the given z-score. Now, I think that makes sense because this 4.18% and this 95.82% should add up to 100% of the data, and it does. Let's take a look at another fairly similar example. We want to determine the area under the normal curve between z equals 1.51 and z equals negative 1.2. Now, if I wanted to estimate where z equals 1.51 is on this graph, I would say it would probably be about right over here. It's between 1 and 2 standard deviations above the mean. And z equals negative 1.2 would probably be somewhere over here, a little bit to the left of 1 standard deviation below the mean. And what we're going to do is use those tables again to find the area between these two z-scores. First, let's look up our z-score of negative 1.2 in the table we had up earlier. If we scroll down, we can find negative 1.2 right here. This is negative 1.2, and then this column here represents 0. So our negative 1.20 z-score gives us an area of 0.1151. So if we go back to our graph, this area in here is 0.1151. Then what we can do is we can look up the z-score 1.51 in our other table. This table we had up earlier was for negative z-scores. We have a positive z-score. So I'm going to bring up our other table here. And we're looking for a z-score of 1.51, which is right here. This table tells us that the area to the left of that z-score is 0.9345. So now, going back to our problem, this area in here to the left of this z-score over here is 0.9345. Now, if we want to find this original pink area in here between our two z-scores, what we can do is we can subtract this area in green from this area in maroon. So the area between our two z-scores is going to be 0.9345 minus 0.1145. 0.51, and I'm getting that that is 0.8194. So what we've learned so far is that if we have a z-score for a given distribution, we can find the area under the normal curve to the left of that z-score from the table. We can then use that information to find the area to the right of a particular z-score, as we did in the previous problem. We can also use that information to find areas between z-scores, as we did in this problem right here. What we haven't talked about yet, though, is how do we find these actual z-scores? What if our z-scores aren't given to us? Well, looking back at this table, we can think of a z-score as how far away from the mean our particular data value is. And when we say how far away, we mean how far in standard deviations. So a z-score of 1 means that we're 1 standard deviation to the right of the mean. A z-score of negative 2 means that we're 2 standard deviations to the left or below our mean. So if we want to find the z-score for one particular data value, what we do is we take that value and we subtract the mean from it. That gives you how far away our data value is from the mean. But if we want this distance measured in standard deviations, what we then do is we divide by the standard deviation. And that is a formula that gives us the z-score of any given data value. Notice that to find a z-score, we need a mean and a standard deviation for our data set. If we want to shorten the formula for the z-score, we can just say z equals, and then our value is going to be called x. We're going to subtract the mean, which we can call mu, and we can divide by the standard deviation, which we call sigma. And those two formulas are the same thing. Let's use these formulas down here in an example problem. We're going to assume math scores on the SAT are normally distributed with a mean of 500 and a standard deviation of 100. We're going to find the z-score for someone scoring 673. So using our z-score formula, our data value that we're looking at is 673. We're going to subtract the mean, which we said was 500, and we're going to divide by the standard deviation, which we said was 100. That gives us 173 on top and 100 on the bottom, and if we divide that out, we get 1.73 as our z-score. Now, I haven't used this notation before, but in your book, they will sometimes put a subscript on this z of whatever the data value is. So we're saying our z-score for the data value 673 equals 1.73. I don't always use that notation, but just in case you see it in the homework, that's what your book is saying. Well, now that we have the z-score, we can answer a bunch of questions about it. For example, what percentile is this score of 673 in? So what we would do is we would look that z-score up in our table. 1.73 is going to be right here in our table. And what this says is that under the normal distribution, the area is 0.9582. So let me draw a little picture. Here's our normal distribution. Here's our z-score of 1.73. The area under this distribution, according to the table, is 0.9582. What that says is that 95.82% of SAT scores fall below that score of 673 on the math portion of the test. To answer the question, that puts you in the 95th or the 96th percentile. Let's take a look at one more example. We're going to assume that the speed of cars on the road during rush hour is normally distributed with a mean of 64 miles per hour and a standard deviation of 5 miles per hour. We're going to select 200 cars at random, and we want to know how many do we expect to be traveling slower than 56 miles per hour. Well, we were given a mean of 64 and a standard deviation of 5, and we want to ask a question about a car that is traveling 56 miles per hour. We know that we have a normal distribution, so a z-score makes sense here. Our z-score formula looks like this, and if we plug our values into our z-score formula, I'm getting this right here, which reduces to negative 8/5, which is negative 1.6. So we just found that traveling 56 miles per hour is 1.6 standard deviations below the average speed of 64 miles per hour. If we look at our normal distribution, this z-score of negative 1.6 falls somewhere over here, and we are asking a question about traveling slower than 56 miles per hour. Slower would be over here to the left of this z-score. We can look up this area right here in our negative z-score table. Negative 1.6 is all the way down here at the bottom, and we find that that area that we marked off is 0.0548. In other words, we have a 5.48% chance that if we choose one random car, they are traveling slower than 56 miles per hour. But we have 200 cars that we're selecting. How many of those 200 cars do we expect to be traveling below 56 miles per hour? Well, we had a 5.48% chance that any one car would be traveling below 56 miles per hour. So if we want to reword this question, what is 5.48% of 200? Well, 5.48 percent of 200 is 0.0548 times 200. I'm getting 10.96, which I guess I will round up to 11 cars. All right, so we covered a lot of ground in this video. This would be a good one to watch more than once, I think. So I'm going to set you loose on this homework set. Let me know if you have questions, and I will see you in the next video.